Well, the map shows a little diamond over here in a vague area, so I must be missing something just right over in that, there in that corner that I didn't see here. Oh yeah, that makes sense. I went through this door, and I think that took me all the way back to the entrance, so I wouldn't have explored this corner yet. That makes sense. I checked the achievement, by the way, the trophy. Invincible. It's just for killing 2,500 enemies. No big deal. No special occurrence happened during that particular combat or anything. It's just, nah, you've hit a milestone over the course of this game. Congratulations. Harden Hightown, Chapter 7. We're still fighting more of these. Wow. By Varric Tetris. Donan Brenokovic searched Comte de Favre's office. The Comte lay dead, murdered while armed and barricaded inside his own home. The servants' rooms were all empty, and from the pulled-out drawers and abandoned trunks, they had been sent away in a hurry. The Comte had clearly expected trouble, and trouble had come to call. The Comte had all of his kept all of his letters. Decades of correspondence sorted by apparently kingdom of origin filled his writing desk. Donan rummaged through them, looking for darker ink, fresher pages, anything that might indicate that it was recent. And then came the shattering sound of someone kicking in the front door. Hey! Milord Fancy Pants, get your ass down here! Jevlin and Donan ran for the foyer. The foyer. A woman stood over the splintered door, her eyes glistening brighter than the daggers in her hands. You there, she snapped at the guardsman. Where's the Comte full of it? We need to have some words. One of them will be coin, and another one will be now. Kirkwall guard, Donan barked back at her. This is a crime scene. Identify yourself. Guards, are you? She smirked, squinting up at the into the dark towards him. No suits of armor outside. Man poking around our noble's house at dark. This does look like a crime scene. Donan didn't flinch. Your name. Belladonna. Captain Belladonna of the Dragon's Jewels. She executed a florid bow that somehow managed to be insulting. Where's the damn Comte? He's dead, Donan said, watching her reaction. You wouldn't know anything about that, would you? She cracked a wry smile. Trust me, sweet thing. If I were to kill him, I'd have waited until he paid me first. What was your business with the Comte? Jevlin spoke up, startling Donan. He'd almost forgotten his partner was there. Cargo transport, she glowered at the recruit. He hired me to deliver some antiques, and I've been sitting at anchor for a fortnight without being paid. She peered up into the dark balconies overhanging the foyer and shouted, Anybody there? Anybody here? You want this rubbish? Come to the docks tonight and pay me 50 sovereigns for it. Otherwise, I'm dumping it in the sea. With that, she turned on her heel and strode away. I kind of want to read this book. Like, and I guess I can to some extent. If I collect all the Harden Hightown chapters, I can just read them in sequence. That's an option, of course. But yeah, I'm enjoying the writing style there. The funny thing is that Harden Hightown has been a quest line on the war table, and one of the main points was like, oh, this story, the Comte's murder differs from the original story. Like, that's how it, one of the things about it being a forgery. But here I am finally finding it. Harden Hightown Chapter 7. Just fucking look where it is. We're in the middle of nowhere. This is one of the hardest places to find that kind of thing, is you have to go find an obscured temple. So I guess they didn't expect me to have already known about that at that point, because so many people would have never found that book. Alright, here we go. The last body part. Switch to Solus real quick to bubble the group. Ah, it's this guy again. Hey, buddy. Oh, a corpse. We'll deal with the ads first. Just, it's good to get rid of the extras as fast as we can, just so that we have as few targets as possible. I'll take it as a grace that we don't have to deal with two of the arcane horrors at once, because that's one of the main parts that where it gets kind of rough. It's just having to deal with so many arcane horrors are hard to kill. In general, there's time. It takes a while to kill them, and they have resistances and so on and so forth, and they're kind of dangerous. So fighting them, having to fight them when there's multiple at a time, that gets a little tougher. But granted, everything's made easier by the fact that everything here is low level compared to me. So I'm saying, when I say tough, I mean like comparatively so, compared to the corpses that don't even get to hit me for the most part. For the first several encounters I had, I was basically just running up to people and I would just bubble the group and then auto and then attack everyone down, and it's like, alright, we win. The arcane auras actually caused some damage, and use up a few of our potions. Let's tell Varric and Vasti to regenerate. Oh, Vasti's running out. I need to get on top of spending Elfrid on the moor. Alright, so, last ritual piece. Let's see what happens. I assume these are all the pieces of a single priestess, so... Or priest. So is the priest going to come back to life? Or is that door going to open? Or I guess we'll find out. Oh, it's the highest one. He's a boss. I'm going to stand over here, far away. Let's see. First of all, Vasti, you go stand over there. Solas can stand over here. And Varric can stand over here. And Sarah can stand over... Let's have Sarah stand like in the back for long range attack. We'll get in position for this potential boss fight. What is it? Is it coming? Maybe Vasti should stand slightly further back, just in case it has like an AoE when it wakes up. Hello? Oh. This isn't happening. It's just a thing I touch. Uh-oh. Okay, here it comes. What is it? Is it the highest one, level 15 boss? Is it just a... Oh, it's just a despair demon, basically. Well, everyone start attacking. And that's why everybody wants a piece of the action. Alright, so I want you to do full draw. Let's cause some damage. That was less damage than I was expecting it to be. Oh, we have some surprise enemies here. Hello, corpses. Backflip. There we go. Need to get some of these adds down just so they don't threaten Solas too much specifically. Bouncing shot. There we go. It's a good place to have it. Yeah, come after me. Come after me, the rogue that generates guard. You'll do a lot of damage to me. Who's hanging out over here? Oh, it's Vasti. How did Vasti get over here? What? You're supposed to be tanking over there. Do I have to go into tactical mode right now for this boss? Is that what's happening right now? Where the high, is that? Oh, the high one's over there. Okay, let's focus on these random assholes. Everyone, attack that guy. Let's see. Solas, do you have bubble up? No, you don't. Okay, no dispel either. You have dispel. You don't have other things. We could have some fun with some of this stuff. First of all, I could potentially use superpowers here. Why the fuck not? Meteor strikes. Let's just make a big ol' mess. I don't use these powers very often. Ta-da! Everyone's dying. Alright. We're getting more... Where's the high one now? Is he still up here? Not moving. Okay. The highest one. Everyone get up.
Get him.
Can I tell Vasti to use his... he's not close enough. He'll be close enough in a second. We can make a mess of this dude. Meteor Strike's making a mess over there. Let's use... Oh, cool. He's frozen, is he? That'll make it easier for him to hit him with this. Ta-da! Fuck you. Take all that damage. Enjoy that. Alright, now let's focus on knocking him over if we can. So, taunt and shield bash. That didn't not work really. Just everything I can to focus on this guy and knock him over and crowd control him a bit if I can. Warhorn just for the general party buff. Shield bash. He's going down in a second here. Things are not going well for this dude. How's everyone else doing on parties? Fuck it. Hail of arrows, why not? Are we still getting attacked here? Oh, we are. By one dude, though. Oh, he's fine. Fucking hail of arrows! Oh, is he going to throw it any... He's not going to really throw it in a good spot? Oh, well then, fuck it. If it's not a good use of hail of arrows, just use something else. We can save it for later. Let's just play as Bastion and whack this guy a bit.
Smack! Thwack! Thwack! Blam! Shazam!
There we go. Comic books. You guys alright down there?
That was the High Priest of the Temple.
Imprisoned in silence and despair by his own followers. A sad legacy.
He was imprisoned by his own followers. Let's put him back together and kill him. Yeah! Oh, hardcore raiding, brah.
That was a weird series of things to do, right? We're gonna carefully explore this entire temple, reassemble this ancient priest, and then murder him. Yay! We could have just let it be. Is he better off now? Is that how this works? I don't know. Either way, through the door that's probably open now, right? Let's see what our reward is. Hello? Oh, mosaic piece. 9 out of 12. Freed our slaves. Is that more exalted planes? I don't know. I don't know which mosaic specifically I'm collecting more of there. I think mosaics are location specific. So it's weird that this place that isn't a specific location still has more mosaics in it. A supply cache. That's interesting. Are things going to keep going or something? Well, I might as well just quickly pop a potion and grab the cache, I guess. It could be a bad idea to use too many supply caches, though. I don't know. Are we about to fight a boss, so they want us to have a new supply of potions? Or is it about to end? What's going to happen here? Search the chamber of the Oracle. Magister Firestaff, garbage. Dearthaman's Wisdom. Unique shield, 17 armor, 2 constitutions, 30% front defense, 4 melee defense, 2 strength, 5% extra damage for each enemy, and 8. Wow. That's pretty cool. I'll have to compare it to Vasti's current weapon, but that specifically, the 5% extra damage for every enemy nearby could be a nice damage boost for any.
Spotted, right?
For any warrior. Let's go ahead and compare. And then I can make a call of which one I like more, and the audience can completely disagree on me and say that the other one's better. Current shield, Mage Hunter. 30% front defense, 12 magic defense, 8 spirit resist. Oh, and 3 guard on hit. So 3 guard on hit is not bad. So, this one, I lose my magic and spirit defense, but I gain melee defense and strength, and I get 5 damage for every enemy within 8 meters. I don't know, man. That 12, having 12 more armor is nice on Mage Hunter, and 3 guard per hit is a nice universal, like, this is always helping me situation, where 5% damage for every enemy within 8% meters. First of all, that means if I'm ever meleeing anyone, I always get 5% extra damage, because that's an enemy that's in front of me, so that's nice. And I guess that could be exponentially stronger, so it could be really effective, but I don't know if it outdoes the defensive capabilities. I don't know. We'll just arbitrarily test run it. It's kind of nice to have something new so every now and then. Because I've been running around with Mage Hunter, which looks like a turtle shell. This thing. I've been running around with this shield for like 30 episodes, I want to say. So let's try something that looks a little different. Oh, that's neato. It's a very small shield. So I'm losing 12 armor and 3 guard on hit. But it might be fun to do extra damage. Because I have a very nice... look, this is Cleave. That's the cool, strong axe we got recently that I had to go to a specific secret spot for. Blammo! Song of the Marshes. 130 more damage than Cleave. That's just how effective a weapon it is. I have just a great weapon. So if it does this much damage and it is going to get a crazy damage bonus from having crowds of enemies nearby, this could actually be pretty effective. I'm definitely keeping both shields. At the very least, whatever one Vasti is not using can be used by Cassandra or Blackwall, who I will occasionally bring along for specific... not really specific quests, mostly just random, like... I'll bring some other people around, why not? So, I believe we're done. I don't see any... the whole section should be gone now, right? Yeah, alright, so... I think we're done with the temples, so... I'll see you guys later. I'm gonna have to go find some other place to go to, because this is... thoroughly completed, and we got a cool reward at the end. Part of me wants to use the shield just to justify the fact that I went through all this ultimately for the reward of getting a shield that it'd be kind of depressing to think isn't even like it'd be disappointing to go through a whole dungeon just for one shield and then be like, it's not as good as the one I have. So part of me is motivated to use it just for that reason. No shit, we're getting attacked by Red Templars. That's a surprise. I was just walking out. Oh shit, that was a surprise. Oh, where'd they go? What? Oh, they're back now. What is going on? That's weird. I'm on my way back to the back gate where I first came in, and yeah. We're just fighting Red Templars now, I guess. This came as a surprise. Part of me wonders, is this a weird hallucination? Because this place is supposed to make you paranoid and crazy. What if I had just fast-traveled out of here is what I'm wondering. Then none of this would have mattered. So, this is strange. Any more Red Templars just going to show up on the way out? That's it? Nah, yeah, that's the entrance. That was strange. Anyway, got anything new to say to me, Cassandra?
Good book?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Wait, are you blushing?
What would I have to blush about?
You tell me.
It's of no interest to you, I'm certain. It's a book.
I can see that.
It's one of Varric's tales. Swords and Shields, the latest chapter.
The latest chapter? Meaning you've read them all?
Not since this all began. We've been busy.
That's just her favorite.
Nobody asked you, Tevinter.
I couldn't finish the last one you lent me. I actually feel dumber for having tried.
It's literature. Smutty literature. Whatever you do, don't tell Varric.
Why not? I think Varric would be pleased to have another fan.
Pleased? Yes, that's one word for it. They're terrible. And magnificent. And this one ends in a cliffhanger. I know Varric is working on the next. He must be. You could ask him to finish it. Command him to... Pretend you don't know this about me.
That was adorable. That was utterly adorable. The funny thing is that, first of all, it's just really a nice, endearing moment that links Varric and Cassandra and Dorian in one scene, which is always great. You get a very human moment from Cassandra of her, reading smut instead of just being a tough soldier all the time. But I also get a kick out of the fact that, of several episodes ago, when I was doing the romance with Josephine, there was the whole thing where, I don't understand your obsession with our Legion culture. I don't understand how you can deal with this shit. I hate it so much. And I made a joke at the end of the episode, I think, saying that this is going to be like dating a girl who likes Twilight, isn't it? Cassandra's basically, literally, not even basically, she's pretty much literally the girl that likes Twilight. So that's pretty funny to me, except without it being Twilight. Instead, it's Varric smut. Yeah, I'm totally going to talk to Varric about it. Let's have some fun.
What can I do for you, Inquisitor?
Cassandra is waiting for the next issue of Swords and Shields.
I must have heard that wrong. It sounded like you just said that Cassandra read my books.
That's exactly what I just said.
Maybe I'm just going crazy. Wait, did you say the romance serial? Oh, she'll be waiting for a while then. I haven't finished it and wasn't planning to. That book is easily the worst I've ever written. The last issue barely sold enough to pay for the ink.
Well, Cassandra seems to be hooked on it.
And I honestly thought a hole in the sky was the weirdest thing that could happen. So, you want me to finish writing the latest issue of my worst serial for Cassandra? Oh, that's such a terrible idea. I have to do it. On one condition, I get to be there when you give her the book.
You've got a deal.
I'll get to work then. You know, the fact that the book is terrible just makes it more worthwhile somehow.
Oh, man. This is gonna be fun. Oh, give Cassandra the latest chapter of Swords and Shields. It's done. How is it already done? How is the book... How fast does Varric write? Maybe the speed of this writing is why Swords and Shield is so bad. Varix is gonna ruin this, huh? He's not gonna just be a witness. He's gonna be like right in her face and ruin this, maybe. I don't know. Still, I'm loving this.
What have you done now?
I get it, Seeker. You're still sore after our spat.
I'm not a child, Varric. Do not suggest I'm without reason.
A peace offering. The next chapter of Swords and Shields. I hear you're a fan.
This is your doing.
Oh, yes. Do you really think I'd miss this?
Well, if you're not interested, you're not interested. Still needs editing anyhow.
Wait!
You're probably wondering what happens to the night captain after the last chapter.
Nothing should happen to her. She was falsely accused.
Well, it turns out the guardsman...
Don't tell me!
This is the part where you thank the Inquisitor. I don't normally give sneak peeks, after all.
I... thank you.
This was everything I'd hoped.
I know how you feel.
I wonder if I have time to read the first part.
Don't forget to tell all your friends, if you have any. Completely worth it.
Oh, well, this is fun. Cassandra plays the tough girl all the time and is so stern. The game literally starts with you being Cassandra's prisoner and everything, but we keep getting more and more scenes where she kind of lets her guard down, or her barriers kind of fall around certain conditions, and like I take her with me in the party, and she's laughing and having a good time with Sarah and stuff like that. Like, she's totally, there's all these humanizing moments where you get to see a chink in her armor, and that's kind of fun. And hey, Cassandra greatly approves. I'll take a chance here. I wonder, I kept asking about her brother and she keeps not wanting to talk about it. I wonder if that was the kind of bump that I need to make her like me enough to reveal that kind of information, maybe.
There is a rumor being circulated. The intent may be slanderous, but it suggests that you and Ambassador Josephine are...
Are what?
Romantically involved.
You're looking romantically involved with that mannequin right now.
Yes, I suppose it's true.
Ah, I must admit I am a little surprised.
I don't see why.
True enough. It is your business, and I will leave it at that.
Do you have any advice for me?
Treat Dorian with caution. It's possible he could be what he seems. A Tevinter mage wishing to do better than his countrymen. What if he is not? At best, his presence makes the Inquisition appear to have questionable allies.
That's enough for now.
Another time, then.
Well, I get what happened there. I think I flirted with Cassandra like once or twice total in the game, and so that might have like led the seed for a potential relationship if you pursue it. So I had to like pick the heartbreak option to sort of like make it clear that that's not where things are going, so that that doesn't pursue that direction now that we've met with Josephine. Anyway, I only ended the conversation because I wanted her to walk away from the mannequin and stop clipping through it, because if she does tell me about her brother finally and it's emotional, I don't want her to be clipping through a dummy the whole time. That's kind of a bad mix of visual and audio.
I trust all is well.
So that book you were reading.
Yes, what of it?
So under that taciturn shell beats a true romantic heart.
Why must it be an accusation? Romance is not the sole province of dithering ladies in frilly dresses. It is passion. It is being swept away by the pursuit of an ideal. What is not to like about that?
It's just a little unexpected.
I don't need anyone picturing me mooning over stolen kisses.
Is that what you're doing? Mooning?
I will never hear the end of this, will I?
Oh, absolutely never.
Do you need something?
I have some more questions.
As you wish.
Tell me about your brother.
Anthony was older than I, a dragon hunter, who showed what a Pentagast could truly be. I idolized him. I wanted to hunt dragons as he did, even though our uncle forbade it. Anthony promised to train me in secret. We would hunt together one day, brother and sister, vanquishing the beasts of old. And then he died on me.
That sounds really awful.
It was the end of everything I knew. A group of apostates wanted dragon blood, and wanted Anthony to get it for them. He refused, and they killed him for it, in front of me. I begged the Chantry to let me become a Templar. Instead, they sent me to the Seekers. It took many years to let go of my drive for vengeance.
I think I understand how you felt.
At times I could not breathe. The rage nearly choked me. I sometimes wonder how different my life would be if Anthony was still alive. Would I be a dragon hunter? Married to some noble fool, a mother of three? I cannot say. I take solace in believing the Maker has a plan, but he is not always kind.
I'll let you get back to work.
All right, so Cassandra... Oh, that poor tree. So Cassandra became a Seeker, or her the whole path where she got here was all because her brother died, and she basically sought revenge and ended up having a whole new calling in life as a result of those events. I wonder if all this progress we've made will trigger something new, or if that's our dead end for now.
Yes?
Do you have any advice for me?
Watch the treasury carefully, with that Sarah present.
You think she's here to rob us?
Possibly not, but I would hardly put it past her.
That's enough for now.
Another time, then.
All right, so we had some fun times and progress with Cassandra today, but we've more or less hit a dead end for now. Still, I like that Varric, because I was frustrated a little bit that when I was talking to Varric, he doesn't really go anywhere. Like when you talk to him, at one point you talk to him and he's like, "Oh, I want to." Bianca shows up and you have the whole storyline where you go with Bianca and you go to the dwarven city that's underground. And you investigate that. But aside from that, when you talk to Varric, he really doesn't trigger scenes very often when every other character does. But I guess the reason for that is that Varric constantly shows up in other people's stories. There's Varric and Cassandra, and earlier we had Varric and Varric shows up in the Cole storyline. Like, he kind of just shows up everywhere because he's more somewhat of a more central character. In many ways, really, it almost feels like Varric shouldn't be a party member. Like, he has the same sort of, always showing up everywhere, almost omnipotent sort of feeling that the three, advisors have. Colin, Josephine, and, Liliana, and now Morgan, I guess. Speaking of Colin, I think I'm gonna check in on him just to see. We pulled the prank on him, I wonder if he's reacting to that. Hey, Colin, you having any trouble with your wobbly table?
First the Templars, now the Grey Wardens. Both devoted their lives to fighting evil. Now they serve it.
What better way to demoralize the people of Thedas than to corrupt their heroes? If Corypheus appears with Templars and Wardens at his side, why shouldn't they follow too?
Because now is not the time to lose hope. The Inquisition must serve as an example. We must stand where others fall.
What do you think of the people you work with?
Who do you mean?
What do you think of our ambassador?
Your opinion is more important than mine where Josephine is concerned. As an ambassador for the Inquisition, she is skilled. We are fortunate to have her.
I should let you get back to work.
We're not going to have a lot of fun with Colin. Apparently he's not going to acknowledge the fact that we messed with his table with Sarah. Oh well, we've had some fun today. Alright, we're still in the same recording session, so Josephine and Colin are still busy, but we've got a message saying Liliana finished her Antiva mission for now, where she was supposed to break into the mansion while he was away. Sister Leliana, our agents entered Lord Enzo's home, where they discovered several pieces of correspondence connecting Enzo to the Venatori. Worse, it seems Enzo did more than buy into their philosophy. He's been arranging to send volunteers to Red Lyrium Mines, as he took these people from Rialto's poorer, more unfortunate residents. Few noticed the disappearances. Our agents were prepared to confront Enzo with the evidence, but he failed to return. We have since learned that they hired a ship to Hercina in the Free Marches. It seems unlikely that Enzo knew of our presence, but something spooked him. Mason. Leliana has written a note below. Have our agents track Lord Enzo to the Free Marches. His work for the Venatori must not continue. Let us pray the trail does not run cold. Leliana. So we get a staff grip, and we get an offer from the Crows, a brand new quest. We'll look into it, but it might not be... an offer from the Crows. It almost sounds like we'll see how Leliana reacts, but it might be a Josephine mission if we're not careful. A letter... So Josephine and Lena can both do it. Colin also... Oh, everyone can do it. Okay. A letter delivered to Skyhold. Its sender claims to be a member of the Antivan Crows, an infamous guild of assassins. We encountered your agents in Hercynia. It seems the Inquisition and the Crows share a target. Our employer bears no love for Lord Enzo due to... Well, let's just say it's a personal matter. Of course, I imagine your motivations have more to do with the man's Tevinter friends. You know the Venatori, we know Enzo. Why compete for the man? Lend us your knowledge and the job will be done far more quickly. You eliminate an enemy, our employer removes a political rival, and we get paid. A happy ending for all involved. It's not a terrible option. We've had so many missions where we had that huge ongoing Grey Warden storyline where so many of them were getting killed during the war we were waging just to kill one enemy. What if we just wiped them out instantly with the Crows? It's not a terrible option. Colin says, do we really want to get tangled up with the Crows? Our people can handle this. Josephine, the Crows are an unfortunate reality of Antivan politics. They will pursue the contract regardless. We may as well know where they are. So, Leliana, cooperating with the Antivan Crows works to our advantage. They have more knowledge of Enzo, and we can gain contacts should we need their assistance in the future. Yeah, Leliana has the exact thing in mind that I was thinking of.
Inquisitor.
Let's do some assassinating. Yeah. And yeah, we're slowly running out of blips on the map. We're getting there. Slowly but surely. What is green? Imagine I should present to you an object which, to my mind, is of indisputable greenness and ask, does this appear to you to be green? Naturally, you might say that it does, for you have to come to recognize the appearance of the color of the object to be green, associating the word with what your eyes see. But could it be my understanding of green differs entirely from yours? What if, perchance, you could see into my mind? You might realize that all things that I name green are actually red in your understanding. Ah. Without the moorings of objective truth, we are set adrift in oceans of solitary experience. The promising open to a lecture given by Karsten Grook, philosopher-poet at the University of Arles. The lecture's quality dropped significantly after this point and ended quickly with Grook subjecting audience members to a poorly constructed ode to chartreuse. He fled from the auditorium under fire from students armed with overripe red tomatoes. Ha, red is in quotes. That's great. That's a weird thing. Like, growing up as a kid, I had this idea of, like, I see colors this way. But what if everyone else sees the colors differently? Like, yeah, the idea, like, what if my green is your red? Like, we wouldn't be able to tell because that would be just the, like, all of our reference points for what colors are and how they compare to each other. Like, well, this is the opposite of that color. Like, everything could be flipped, potentially. Like, all of our reference points for how colors work could be in contrast with each other, and we wouldn't have a way of knowing. And then, as I got older, I started seeing that, like, people just would randomly bring that topic up. Like, other people had that thought on their own. Vsauce did an episode about it, about the idea of, like, what is this color, basically? Like, do we see colors the same as each other? And here we have a little codex piece in Dragon Age having the exact same topic. is this like a, I wonder, just go ahead and leave a comment, I guess, thinking about this, like, is this a universal question? Does everyone just sort of consider this concept at some point because it's kind of just a natural thing to think about, or am I crazy? I don't know. I just found it novel that I thought about this as a kid and then keep encountering other people with the same thought process for some reason.